Those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. 3 years ago today, a massive 9.0 magnitude earthquake triggered a devastating tsunami that struck Japan's northeast coast. The twin disasters resulted in an unprecedented nuclear crisis, a triple meltdown at the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power station. 3 years later, about 267,000 people are still living in temporary housing and other makeshift facilities. Many cannot return home due to high levels of radiation. The cleanup and decommissioning effort at Fukushima could take decades. In February, the owner of the nuclear plant, the Tokyo Electric Power Company, or TEPCO, said about 100 tons of highly radioactive water had leaked from one of the hundreds of storage tanks at the devastated plant. On Sunday, thousands of Japanese residents marched to parliament and called on the new Japanese government of Prime Minister Shinzo Abe not to restart some of Japan's 48 idled reactors. Speakers at the rally included former Japanese Prime Minister Naoto Kan, who held the post at the time of the Fukushima meltdown.
I believe that now is the crucial time for us to eliminate nuclear power, or we forgive the Abe administration, which is going in the opposite direction.
Since the Fukushima crisis, Naoto Kan has become a vocal critic of nuclear power, saying it's too dangerous for Japan to keep open any of its nuclear plants. Up until the time of Fukushima, he was a longtime supporter of nuclear power. In this exclusive extended broadcast interview, I sat down with former Prime Minister Naoto Kan when we were in Japan in January. I began by asking him to talk about what happened 3 years ago today on March 11, 2011. Naoto Kan is translated in the interview by Mary Joyce.
On that day, at the time of 2:46 in the afternoon on Japanese time, I was at the House of Councillors for a budgetary committee meeting. At that time, the earth started to shake, and then when the committee went into a break, I returned straight back to go back to the office, and also went within my official residency there to the Crisis Management Center, and first trying to gather information about this earthquake and tsunami which had just occurred. And at that time, the first information that we received in regards to the nuclear power plant was that although the earthquake had hit, it was safely stopped all of the operations at the plant. And so hearing this information, I initially felt very relieved. However, not less than 1 hour after that, I received information that at the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant, all of the electricity had been stopped, and not only this, but all of the cooling functions at the plant had failed. And at the time of hearing this information, I felt this terrible chill or cold all over my body, and a feeling which I can never forget. And the reason for this was, of course, knowing that even though the nuclear plant had been stopped for a long time after this, it was continuing in this critical situation, and there was the potential risk that the nuclear fuel could actually go into meltdown.
And so what did you do?
So at the time, one of the first things I did following the nuclear disaster was to set up a control center to deal with this, and set up to lead this center three people in particular, one being a staff from the NISA, one being a representative of the expert academics group on nuclear power safety and regulations, and one person also from representing TEPCO, who was actually the former vice president of the company. And one of the first things that we set up this center to try and do is to find out what the actual situation in the plant was, what was really happening, and also try to make predictions about what would happen from there. However, at that time, at first, it was almost impossible to have any kind of accurate information. And so the first thing that we found out at the time was we were considering that the reactor 1 at Fukushima Daiichi was the most likely to be in a very serious situation and have serious problems. However, even at the night of that first day of March 11, what I was being told, being reported, was that the water levels were safely above the level of where the fuel rods were located within the container. And however, now we know that actually the measuring equipment to measure the water level was broken at that time. And only 4 hours after the earthquake occurred, actually, was when it experienced meltdown in the reactor 1. And even through the container of thickness 20 centimeters, there was actually a hole being burned through, and the melted fuel had been actually leaking through to the outside of the container. And now we know this information, that this was happening at 7 p.m. approximately on that day. But at the time, none of this information was accurately conveyed to me. And this was actually the first incident of an accident where a hole in the pressure container was actually or a hole had been created. Even at the time of the Three Mile accident, while there was a partial fuel meltdown inside the container, it wasn't gone to the extent of actually having a hole in the container and leaking through in this way. So the Fukushima accident was the first accident to actually melt down in this kind of way, and it was a situation very close to what we call perhaps the China syndrome. And also at this time, because of the high levels of pressure inside the container, there was the need to open the vents to release some of this pressure. However, the debate in regards to how to go about doing this was going between the actual site, the TEPCO headquarters in Tokyo, and my office. So within these three locations, the debate and the discussion going back and forth. And it was very difficult to obtain accurate information and to know what was really happening. And so the next morning at around 6 a.m., very early, I decided that the best thing to do would be to speak directly with the person responsible at the site. So I departed at 6 a.m. by helicopter to go to the Fukushima Daiichi site. And there I met with Mr. Yoshida, who was the person responsible at the plant, and he explained to me about the situation from his perspective, which was occurring on the site. And he was a very clearly spoken man, which meant that it was very much a plus in terms of considering how to deal with the situation.
Wasn't TEPCO management saying the same thing to you as this man you spoke to, the head of the actual plant, when you flew there?
From what I was hearing from the headquarters of TEPCO, and in particular from Mr. Takeguro, who was the former vice president, had almost no accurate information being conveyed about what was actually the situation on site. And one other important and serious issue at the time also was, in the case of a nuclear disaster, the system which was in place, well, the Prime Minister and the Prime Minister's office would be in the head of, the measures to be taken, the office of what to be done from there. But the bureaucratic organization which was established to support that function was within the NISA, which is actually located within the Ministry of the Economy. And so the person who was seconded to explain to me from the NISA about what was happening was actually not an expert on nuclear issues or nuclear power, but an economic expert. And so through his explanation, it was impossible to know the actual situation of what was happening in the reactor. And so through this situation, it really showed to us that in the case of such a severe accident, the whole situation of the allocation of staff, which was in place, and what should be done in that case, and what kind of human resources were needed for that, and also what kind of hardware was needed for that, it became clear that no precautions had been put in place, no consideration of what to actually do if a nuclear disaster really happened. This hadn't been prepared for at all.
What was the worst case scenario that you understood at this point, Mr. Khan?
So at the time that the accident happened, and for the first week from there, I didn't return at all to my own house, but remained within the office within the official residence. And every time there I was alone, I would consider, well, how much worse can this accident get? How could it expand? What could happen? So at the time, what I was thinking about was about the accident at Chernobyl. Of course, the accident there was of huge scale, but there was one reactor in this case, in Chernobyl. However, when we were thinking about the situation at Fukushima, at the Daiichi plant, there are 6 reactors and 7 spent fuel pools. And then 12 kilometers from there, at the Daini, the second Fukushima nuclear power plant, there are 4 additional reactors and 4 spent fuel pools, meaning that when you combine both Daiichi and Daini together, there's 10 reactors and 11 spent fuel pools altogether. And if we were to lose control of all of this, it would mean that the accident, the disaster, could be on a scale of many tens or even 100 times more radioactive materials being released than what happened at Chernobyl. And so thinking about this made me also think about the risk of the possibility that maybe even areas including Tokyo might need to be evacuated. And after this, I asked Mr. Kondo, who was the head of the nuclear committee, to simulate what a kind of worst-case scenario could be. And this simulation was presented to me on March the 23rd, I believe it was. And within this scenario, it said that the worst case could mean having to evacuate up to a 250-kilometer radius of the area, as in this map in my book, which I have just shown. And this is almost the same as what I was fearing could be the worst scenario personally also. And so in the case where a 250-kilometer radius area would have to be evacuated, that would involve 40% of the population of the whole country of Japan. This is talking about a population of something like 50 million people. And so when we think about this, or thinking about Japan as a country in the long term, it would suffer extreme damage, and how to even consider functioning in such a situation. So we were really just on the verge of such a situation as this.
In their book, Strong in the Rain, the journalists Lucy Birmingham and David McNeil reported that when the NISA, that's the Nuclear and Industrial Safety Agency spokesman, Koichiro Nakamura, let slip soon after the earthquake that meltdown was a possibility, meaning core fuel melt inside at least one of the reactors, he was removed from his post. Who removed him?
Well, first of all, in regards to the meltdown, from the very first stages of after the disaster, I was speaking with, of course, the NISA, but also TEPCO and people from the Nuclear Safety Committee and also other experts and so on. And from hearing all of these different opinions, I personally, at least, also felt that there was a risk of potentially experiencing a meltdown. And so in regards to how the government at the time was explaining to the public of Japan of what was happening, each day in the morning and afternoon, the chief of cabinet would be giving a press conference to explain the situation. And as well as this, the NISA was also giving their press conferences. And in regards to the contents of your specific question, this particular spokesperson gave information that had not actually been reported to the cabinet's office, to the chief of cabinet, in advance to this. And there was an, you know, there should have been an agreement where if the NISA was going to be making any such announcements or having this kind of new information, it should be, of course, reported to the cabinet office. Otherwise, there would be differences in the information which was being presented. And so I believe that that was perhaps involved in the background about why this there was this change in the position and spokesperson. But this decision was not made by politicians, but internally within the organization.
So there's the possibility of having 40% of Japan evacuated. What happened next?
And so first of all, in the case of Japan, we do not have actually a rule for in the case of martial law. 90 years ago, at the time of the Great Kanto earthquake, this kind of law was in place. But however, there's kind of function that exists within the Japanese system. And so first of all, I was thinking, well, in the case where we would have to evacuate these 50 million people, there would have to be very strong decisions or strong authority in terms of the logistics of this, for example, transportation or how to go about this. However, at the time when I received the worst case scenario from Mr. Kondo on March 23rd, this was actually, we could see that we had managed to avoid perhaps one of the biggest potential crises which could have happened. Although the reactors had already happened to explode at reactors 1, 3, and 4, and three of the reactors had already by this stage gone through meltdown, it had been possible also to start to inject water, and so the temperature within the reactors was becoming somewhat less. And so at the time of this report being issued on the 23rd, we could see that hopefully there would not be a need for such a full-scale evacuation as this worst-case scenario laid out.
Former Japanese Prime Minister Naoto Kan, one of the most notable opponents of nuclear power since the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear disaster. He was head of the country at the time of the crisis and resigned later that year, but not before he ordered the closure of the Hamaoka nuclear power plant and froze plans to build new reactors. Back with Prime Minister Kan in a moment.